Welcome, this is Colliding Worlds and I'm Angela Valenti Romeo. Today we're at Jorge Mendez Gallery, which is located in Palm Springs, California. What's really special about today is we're going to be speaking to VLADIMIR CORA, somebody who started out life never realizing what an impact he was going to have on the art world. And this is what happens when you dream, you follow your dreams and you follow your instincts. VLADIMIR is not school educated, he's self-taught. He's had wonderful mentors and he has stayed true to himself during this whole time. This body of work that's in front of us is his latest work. You can see his work in museums, you can see it in private collections, but rarely do you get the opportunity to sit and talk with him, and we're going to do that in just a minute. So stick with us and we'll be right back.
Welcome to Colliding Worlds, an art documentary in a 30-minute format. Come with us as we take you on another journey.
It's just a visual connection.
There's a man who's not sleeping on the sofa tonight.
You bet.
That was a lot of years ago about my mom.
That's a good point.
I want to welcome you both to Colliding Worlds and thank you for your time. And we're going to go kind of hear a little bit more about what makes you tick, VLADIMIR. How did you get started painting?
Bueno, esto es un poco largo, ¿no? Porque si quiero decirlo todo, pues es...
I started as an accident. He was a very young boy living or working with his aunt in a pharmacy, in a family-owned pharmacy. And he already tried music before, and he wasn't successful at music. So one day at the pharmacy, when he was bored, and he was feeling disoriented with not knowing what to do, by accident, he picked a cultural magazine, and in the magazine he saw these paintings of Diego Rivera and Siqueiros, and he said, why am I attracted so much to these paintings? And that's when he realized that that's what he would like to try to do. Somebody advised him that there was a cultural center for younger people or younger painters where they will get together and try to create art. And this person advised him to go there. He spent days and days at this center, and finally somebody noticed him and told him, I have seen you here for a while, would you like to give this a try? And he said, absolutely, and that's how he started.
When you started painting, you were painting from the heart. You painted things that you knew. What was so important about capturing these faces?
Bueno, lo que me motivó para...
I'm not sure the name of this island in English is the Pascua Island. Right. It's where these huge heads exist, I think. You know about that one, right? Well, he said in 2004, he saw these big heads and he was very impressed by it. And then that's when he decided that that's what he needs to create, but in the form of painting initially. But then he also started working on the sculptures, on big life-size sculptures. And that was his main idea, to recreate these big heads that he saw on the island of Pascua. And that's how he started. But also around that time, he was invited by a community in his hometown to a transfer of government from one to another one. And he went to this meeting. Part of this group of people are called the Coras. It's an indigenous group. And when he was in this transfer of government, he saw an ocean of heads of all this group of people. And that's where his inspiration came. He saw all these heads and he said, that's what I need to paint. That's what I need to concentrate on.
The faces have their own personality without being any one person in particular. Is that conscious on your part or is that just happenstance?
Podría ser conscientemente, pero no lo es.
They look alike unconsciously. He does this unconsciously, but in a natural way. It just comes naturally because he said this Cora group that lives in Nayarit, they, for some strange reason, they all look very alike. They all look very similar. So he says if you know, any of us go and see them, they will, we will think that they all are the same, but he said they all are different people. He's also done portraits thinking about his wife, his two daughters. The name of one is Adilene, the other one is Alika, but always ends up having the resemblance of the Cora group.
He leans towards the female figure and birds, the crane, the raven, they seem to pop up fairly often in his work. Is there something symbolic for you with the birds, and what draws you, other than the obvious, to the female figure?
No solamente los pintores, los escultores, sino también.
First of all, he's a big admirer of the beauty, of women's beauty. He's a married man, of course, and he loves his wife, but he said he always admired beautiful women. Such as yourself, Angela, he says. So whenever he sees a beautiful woman, he sees them as an artist. He sees them as, you know, as what a doctor will see a patient like. And the way he looks at them is with that artistic eye. He also says that, you know, not only musicians and or poets, you know, dedicate their work to women, but also painters should do that. And that's his take of that. But he's just a big admirer of the beauty in women. And the forms and the shapes and the faces and everything that has to do with the beauty in a woman. And that's where his inspiration comes from. About the birds, he said there's a big migration of birds in Nayarit, the state where he's from. And they actually have a festival of the migration of the birds. And that is where his inspiration for the birds comes from the migration of these birds from the States to Mexico and vice versa. And he, in a way, he sees that as the migration of Mexicans coming to the United States. And that's where he found his inspiration to work with on birds.
You've chosen to stay in Mexico. You've chosen to remain close to home. Why? You're an artist. Your work is well respected. Why did you decide to stay close to home?
Siempre ha sido para mí muy importante porque, bueno, una porque pues ahí nací.
First of all, he was born in Mexico and he loves his country. He loves his town. He loves his state. He was born in a town called Acaponeta, Nayarit, and he just loves it. Then he says, why should I leave my town where I find all the inspiration for my paintings, for all the paintings that the world can appreciate, all the themes of birds and women and the Cora group. You know, if he moved to the States, if he decided to come to the States, he probably wouldn't find that kind of inspiration. He would probably find another inspiration, but it won't be the same. He also says that he understands there are women everywhere, there are birds everywhere, but what he cannot find everywhere is the colors of this town, the colors that he can find when the summer comes and it rains and the flowers start blooming with all these different colors that we are appreciating on his paintings now. He loves the United States, he loves the culture, he loves the past, and he's been in Europe a few times, but he absolutely, a place where he wants to exhibit his work is the United States. But a place to live will be Mexico because he just loves the town and he that's the source of his inspiration.
As an artist now, a well-established artist, do you feel an obligation to mentor the next generation that's coming behind you?
Sí, claro. Eso lo he hecho muchísimas veces. Y le respondo rápido porque es la verdad.
Absolutely. He's been doing that for a number of years. He actually has been taking his art to different communities in Mexico. Unfortunately, lately he had to stop because of the social and political situation that we all are aware in Mexico. It became a little dangerous for him to be traveling around to these communities. But he's been teaching to kids, especially to kids, different forms of art. He's been creating some programs where he was teaching young adults about art. He's been taking his art and showing it and exhibiting to senior citizens, but more importantly to children. So he has been doing that. He thinks he's very important for him to be a mentor for the next generation. And he does that every time he gets a chance.
You're leaving a legacy. When the day comes when we've all left, What do you want people to look at your work and see?
Bueno, no he pensado en eso. Pero sí he pensado que un día me tengo que ir.
He has not thought about the legacy. He has thought about the, you know, the time where he will have to go, and he knows that's very real, just as it is that we are sitting here. But what he thinks about is all the good and the bad things that he does. So far, you know, the things that come to his mind, since he hasn't thought about the legacy, but the good things that he thought about and comes to his mind are what he's been doing with the municipal district and areas in the Nayarit area, taking and teaching his art to kids. So since he hasn't thought about the legacy, till this point, he thinks maybe some of those good things that he's doing with the children will become a legacy. And he's hoping that when he's not here any longer, one of those kids will remember him as the good painter, or as he's saying, oh, that guy with the long hair that he thought he was a good artist.
You've done an amazing body of work, but you're not done yet. Where do you see your next challenge?
Bueno. No, no pienso en el futuro, sino más bien creo en el momento. Cada día.
One of his biggest challenging, well, he thinks that, you know, he doesn't think too much about the future. He thinks the future is very unpredictable, and he tries to concentrate more on the present. He's been thinking, however, he's been thinking a little bit about, he has some political aspirations. He thinks a lot about, he loves Acaponeta, his town. He loves Nayarit, which is his state. And he thinks the way politically and socially, the way things are going there are not according to what they used to be in the 50s and 60s. And he does have some political ambitions. He wants to run for office and become a governor of the state of Nayarit, so he can help the people there, so he can change the way things are going down there right now. And at the same time, he's also thinking about his art. He's also thinking about his artwork. You know, he has to balance, like if he goes into this political state or phase, what is going to happen with his art. But he thinks it's very important for him to teach the children and to change the way things are going. So it sounds, or it looks like he's found himself at a crossroad where he really needs to make a decision. And it sounds to me that he is going to try to go with the political ambition that he has, but because he just loves his town. As far as his painting goes, he is gonna, he wants to go in this style of painting that is called retablo. And retablo is, you know, something that he found in churches, like in Mexico, are very popular. And that's where he's getting his next inspiration for. That's where he's gonna go with his next series of paintings. And that is gonna be a couple of his challenges.
Is there a work that you've created that you've stood back and just, it took your breath away, that you couldn't believe that you had created something so beautiful?
No.
No?
No. No, porque, es difícil contestar esa pregunta, pero dije.
His first response and very quick response is no. There is nothing that he will look at and just be amazed of that, you know, that he created or he worked on it. He said every single piece of art that we're looking at, he created with honesty, with all his heart, with all his passion. That is for sure. But he concentrates on the future pieces. So whatever he created now, and he gives example of the nudity on the balcony, which is his most recent piece. He just finished it a couple of days ago. He said he was in love with that piece the day he finished it. But he, in a way, he lost interest the following day because he started thinking about his next creation. So that's why he says no to that question, just because he concentrates on the future piece. And another example he gives is that piece right there, which is called Fragmented Nature. The model in that piece was his wife, Mary, and he was in love with the piece the day he created, but the following day he was already thinking about his next piece.
I know we've talked a lot about you and your work, but really when you walk away from this seat, what do you want the people to know about you? What do you want them to know about you as the person?
Bueno, si es importante.
Well, one of the things that he wants people to know about him, that is a very humble man. He's a very humble artist, and I can probably attest to that, because when I was starting my gallery, I have contacted different artists, a lot of them, and there were some of them without even half of Vladimir's trajectory that said no to me because I didn't have a previous gallery or because I didn't come from a family of gallerists. When I approached Vladimir with the idea of exhibiting his work in my gallery, he didn't think twice about it. Without even asking me or questioning me, he said yes, because he liked the idea of a Latin American gallery here in Palm Springs. So I can testify that he is probably the most humble artist that I ever worked with. And he wants people to know that he, there's no arrogance in him. He's not selfish, he's not arrogant. He doesn't have any ego. You know, he, just because he's been exhibited in museums or in different galleries around the world, he doesn't think too much of himself. He doesn't think he's better than anybody. And I can guarantee that he's absolutely right when he says that. A few things that he regrets in life is he concentrated too much in his art. He concentrated a lot in his work. And you know, naturally, when you concentrate on something, you leave your family aside. You think, okay, my wife is taking care of my kids, so they should be okay. But it's not okay, and he recognizes that. He made a few mistakes. He made a few mistakes by leaving his children, by not taking his son to a football game or taking his daughters to school. So those are the things that he regrets in life, and he's trying to amend them. He's trying to correct them. He absolutely loves his family. Family is very important for him. It's number one. And he says, regardless whether you are a musician or a painter or, you know, sculpture, family should always be important. He loves his wife, Mary. He loves his three kids, Adilene, Alika, and Vladimir. And he wants to make sure that they understand that his love for them is absolutely important.
It's been a pleasure to meet you. The work speaks for itself, and this is just a great opportunity for people to see more of about what you're about.
Yo pienso que no. Yo yo bueno yo creo que
he's very thankful for your interview, for your time. He's very happy to come back to Palm Springs. It brings a lot of memories to him of his beginnings in the 80s with Rufino Tamayo. He's very thankful to be here. The town represents a lot for him. He loves the streets, the houses, the structure, the architecture, and he's thankful. Oh, actually, he mentioned that when I brought the idea of the gallery to him, he was thrilled about it. So am I. And I do want to thank you too for your time and for your support.
I think this is great. Thank you, Ben.
Imagine the future where your body renews itself and the aging clock is reversed. The future is here. Introducing FDA-approved Aerosys Imperfector non-surgical face and body lift. Perfector cellular anti-aging face treatment lifts and firms sagging skin, erases wrinkles, diminishes dark spots, and heals acne. Aerosys body lift will instantly tighten loose skin, diminish cellulite, promote weight loss, and detoxify. Let the transformation begin by healing from within.
This portion of Colliding Worlds is brought to you by Daniel James Ryan Photography.
Hi, this is Angela Valenti-Romeo, and this is Colliding Worlds. We're going to introduce you to a very, very interesting personality, Eddie Choat. We're going to learn what it's like to be a metal fabricator slash artist slash man about town slash award-winning karaoke singer. This stuff is amazing. Did you have kind of like a Jules Verne childhood, or what was it that pushed you to this direction?
I'm an avid reader, and I collected Marvel comic books when I was a child.
When I looked at these, there were two things that ran through my mind. I felt like a little child. It was like, oh my God, these are so cool, and I just wanted to play with them. And there was this other part of me that was like, oh my God, these are just so cool, because when you look at how they're made.
Before I came here, I go to these shows, right, and these would all be set out, right? And you see these old men with their wives come traipsing along, and they have this permanent grimace on their face. They're hating life, you know, they just don't want to be there. And all of a sudden, you'd see them look at Casey Jones here or whatever, and all of a sudden, their faces would erupt into this 12-year-old boyish grin. And you could see the imagination fire off in his eyes. And I saw it time after time after time. It was the big joy of doing this, was that it would, you know, when somebody takes this home, every time they come walking around that corner, that's gonna happen to them.
You can't help but smile.
They get this silly smile and their imagination goes woo, you know, and for a split second, they're doing the Casey Jones thing or the airship thing or whatever.
I like how you got to all of this, because you didn't start out making these, you started out doing race cars.
Right.
Tell me how race cars lead you to this. Erector sets.
Okay, well, let me give you an example. In 1971, I was building a race car, single-seater, unlimited, for a rich fellow named John Steen. And at some point in the process, you build the whole car, you take it all apart, and then you chrome and paint everything and put it all back together. And he happened to walk up just at the moment where the frame was sitting there on the rack, completely stripped, raw metal, shining, polished, and the sun came out and hit this thing with a beam of light, and all of a sudden, this thing's twinkling on the rack. And John come walking up behind me, and he goes, oh my God, that's the most beautiful piece of metal art I've ever laid eyes on. And I stood around, and I looked at him, and I went, oh my gosh. It was like somebody clicked on a light, and from that moment on, every other car I built, when I mounted an oil cooler, it didn't just get a couple of brackets. I mean, it was a little more like Eiffel Tower construction. You know, a little more intricate, a little more shape to it. 2 months after I had that meeting, can I get up or
sure.
Does that ruin everything?
Go right ahead.
I built this.
And you still have it.
In 1972, a little heavy.
I got it here. And why would you sell it? It's the first one.
I'm building the third one now.
Oh my.
And believe me.
Tell me what
it's
made from.
It's going to be a little more intricate than this one.
Well, you have to start somewhere. And this one is...
Exactly.
If you look at some of the other work, it's much more intricate. But tell me what the parts are.
Well, since I was working at a VW shop, I used VW parts. Hubcaps, generator parts, exhaust valves, generator parts, and a big old hunk of steel, and the rest of its welding rod.
Do people think you were crazy when you started building these?
No, that was the strange thing. My father, when he caught me doing this, I was supposed to be doing something else. And he walked up, he took one look at it, and this is a guy that like would blow up in a moment's notice if something was wrong. And he just stood there with his glassy-eyed stare and pretty much watched it happen. I was amazed. I was ready for the bomb to go off any second.
But see, you were ahead of your time, because now it's very in to use reclaimed pieces, reclaim metal, and turn them into something else and give them a new life.
I started this when I was 7 and a half. When I lived in Seal Beach, I was one block down the road from the Stan Miller Boat Shop. In the Stan Miller Boat Shop, they threw away teak, mahogany, veneers, all this fantastic wood they threw in the dumpster. I learned how to dumpster dive at a very early age. I learned how to recycle at a very early age. I built battleships. And then went down to the Long Beach Lagoon, and we floated them, all the boys, we have a little war, you know, to have a ball. A couple years later, I got my first sand buggy. And the only reason I got it was for my dad to get me out of his. which is one of the most radical ones out there at the time, and almost a little unsafe. So,
child endangerment.
I was the only kid in Seal Beach that had a sand buggy sitting in the garage instead of a surfboard. I'm a big Jules Verne fan, H.G. Wells, Edgar Rice Burroughs, John Norman. You know, they're just fantastic.
They could create a picture and create a place for you just by words. You could see everything they were talking about in your own mind. You can interpret it any way, but they were brilliant when they wrote. They were very colorful. These kind of look like some of their dreams.
Well, for example, this is my version of the Nautilus. It's not the same as the one in the movie. You know, I could have built the same, but I didn't. Same with Casey Jones. The robot, I was selling at a show, and this fellow walked up, and he's all, ooh, this is neat, grabs my Klingon warship. I mean, he lit up like a beacon when he found that ship. He skidded to a stop. I couldn't believe it. And he said, man, you ought to build a robot. Well, guess what I was doing the next morning?
Building a robot.
Build a robot.
I feel like I'm sitting here with an 11-year-old boy. I feel like I'm sitting with my nephew, who used to be just fascinated because I gave him a box that a car was in that he could care less about, but he had the box. And the box to him was like so much more fun than the car could ever
be.
Sure,
it could be a fortress.
and I feel like I'm sitting here with that same child, because you're excited about what you do. You love what you do. These are creations that are, you can't help but smile about.
See that little stubby starship hanging up over there, the short one with the blue nose?
Yes, I do.
Okay. I built a pair of those, a short one and a long one. 2 years before I even found out there was such a thing as steampunk, right? One day my son calls from Concord, California, up by Napa, and said, hey Dad, guess what you're a part of? And I went, what? He said, you're a steampunker. Oh, really? And he sent me this, which I immediately devoured, read the whole thing cover to cover, and discovered, in fact, he's right.
The steampunk movement.
I mean, I got one foot in this.
Yeah. The whole steampunk philosophy is kind of interesting. What makes it steampunk?
A certain amount of antiquity blended with a certain amount of fantasy, I would say.
And it goes back.
I mean, here we have the ship flying through the air, powered by steam. I love that. I mean, I get all kinds of crazy images of possibility with that. The ultimate RV. Odd to have one.
When you show your work and bring smile to people, do some people think you're a madman?
No, because I have built things much more serious. My race car finished the Mexican 1000. I had the first female co-driver. I invented Category 9. I've got to stand in the light. I've got to bathe in the glow.
And give us a little karaoke to take us into like our imagination now. We're going to float away onto one of these little ships to the karaoke sounds of...
Way out here they got a name for rain and wind and fire. The rain is Tess, the fire is Joe, and they call the wind Mariah.
And we're gonna leave you here with those sounds. And I'm telling you, you can't help but smile. With these, and sitting next to this man, you just can't help but smile. Eddie, thank you so very much.
Very nice meeting you.
This has been great. Thank you.